Hello, good morning, sir.
Ma'am, good morning, ma'am. Sir is
ma'am,
not there. Okay.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah, ma'am.
Yes,
let me
Brother, sir, shall I start?
yes
Sir is
ma'am
not in the line, ma'am.
yeah ma'am
Good morning, delightful morning to all. It's my great pleasure to welcome everyone on behalf of PG and Research Department of Computer Science, Devanamar College for Women Autonomous Velupuram, in collaboration with Pantech e-learning private limited Chennai, organizing 2 days free online workshop on role of IPR on innovation, artificial intelligence and machine learning. The main objectives of this workshop to encourage the young participants in the field of artificial intelligence and machine learning, and to motivate all the participants to understand the importance of algorithm, how to incorporate that in the future decision making. I feel honored to welcome our chief guest, Mr. James Ajesh, manager of Pantech e-learning private limited Chennai, who accepted our invitation for giving the chief guest address. I welcome you, sir. I extend my pleasant welcome to our technical resource person, Ms. Nadia, project engineer, Pantech e-learning private limited Chennai. I welcome you, ma'am. I wholeheartedly welcome our chairman, sir, and secretary, sir, ESSK Educational Charities, for the presence of joining the inaugural function. I welcome you, sir. I would like to welcome our beloved principal, Dr. M. Brinda, ma'am, who is supporting us for all our activities. I welcome you, ma'am. I would like to extend my warm welcome our Dean Research, Dr. J. Kalaimathi, for giving us their concern and encouragement. I welcome you, ma'am. I very much delighted to welcome our faculty members for taking all the effort to be with us for this program. Welcome you all. I feel honored to welcome our young and energetic students, those who are actively participated with involvement for this 2 days online free workshop. Welcome you all. Now I take this opportunity to introduce our chief guest, Mr. James Ajesh, manager of Pantech Group of Companies. He served 16 years in this training field. He creates the technical excellence and opportunities to the students and faculty of educational institutes. Inside, he is going to be transformative with the technical trends with the empower of knowledge in the society to create promotions also. So now I will introduce our technical resource person, Ms. Nadia, project engineer. She has completed her MA degree in Anna University, and her area is artificial intelligence and machine learning. She is having good exposure and working experience, and also in good technical skills in artificial intelligence and machine learning. He is having a programming skills in deep learning, image processing, Python, artificial intelligence, and machine learning. She developed real-time projects, and she is going to be handling machine learning algorithm today, such as classification algorithm, regression algorithm, clustering as k-means clustering algorithm. So about this workshop, The role of IPR, intellectual property rights, is an essential for creative rights over an original piece of work and invention. So we have to develop a product and we have to get an intellectual property rights in that. With the emergence of digital age, instances of plagiarism and strict laws are prevent in the intellectual property. So we have to create an atmosphere of trust and to encourage the innovations in the field of computer science. So today we are having a decision intelligence, right? Decision making is an artificial intelligence, a new thing which is just in IT field. It contrasts with artificial intelligence and machine learning. Decision intelligence permits the business utilization of artificial intelligence. It better benefits and the development of business. And subsequently, it assists the organizations with opening the worth of their information through artificial intelligence technology. So Devanamal College for Women is associated with Pantech Solution, is providing this opportunity for 2 days workshop training program. So everyone can enlighten their career with the digital e-learning with recent trends in the fields along with an experienced experts. So I welcome you all for this session. And I thank to give this opportunity for welcome address and introductory of the guest and about the workshop. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Can I start, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am.
Very good morning to all. In this session, this is second day workshop on AI and ML. In this session, we will discuss about some of the library package in Python. That's where we use the in machine learning. Then one by one, we discussed about the machine learning algorithms also. First one is NumPy. NumPy is one of the basic package in Python. That is numerical Python. The NumPy is a general purpose array that's processing the package and it's provide a high performance and multi-dimensional array object. It also has some function for working in domain of linear algebra and the Fourier transform and the matrices also. So the NumPy was created in 2005 by Travis and Talis Elephant. This is one of the open source project. One of the open source project and you can use it freely. This one is one of the open source library package. Why we use the NumPy means, in Python we have lists, right? So that serve a purpose of array. But they are very slow in process. Here we use NumPy means the main aim of NumPy is to provide an array object that is up to 50% faster than the traditional Python list. So that array object in NumPy is called normally n-dimensional array, that is nd array. So it provides a lot of supporting functions that make work with the normal n-dimensional array very easily. So here the array are very frequently used in data science and where the speed and the resources are very important. In our machine learning, we use some data set, right? All the data sets have some numeric values and it have some rows and the columns. We have 4 to 5 rows and columns, mean we can easily access using a list or array. But in our data set, we have more than 2000 rows and columns. That huge amount of data handling using the array is very difficult. So using NumPy, the NumPy is handle the data 50% faster than the other traditional Python list and array. Here, this NumPy arrays are stored at one continuous place that mentioned the memory, unlike to list. So it process can access and manipulate them very efficiently. This behavior is called the locality of reference in computer science. So this is the main reason why NumPy is faster than list. So also it's optimized to work with the latest CPU architecture also. This one is the example for array in NumPy. Here we declare the array, and here the rank of the array is 2 because it have 2 dimensional and it have 2 axes. The first dimension is the length of the array is 2, and the second dimension that has the length of the array is 3. So the overall the shape can be expressed as 2, 3, right? Okay, let me share my IDLE window. Here I open a new window. All are know the NumPy is worked with our regular array, right? So we can create a NumPy ND array object by using the array function. So here, first thing we want to import NumPy. Before that, we must install the NumPy package. So you just open the new. Go to open file, and within the script, open command prompt, give pip install NumPy. I already have that package. Okay, so it shows your requirement is already satisfied. Not only in this package, for all the packages, we just use pip install and with its package name. That's enough to download that packages. Then next, we must import our package. So give import
then NumPy. Okay, that's enough. But in every place where we call NumPy, we use the NumPy dot evitates function. So it is difficult in sometimes. So here I assume using alias, I give NumPy as np. So not only np, any one variable we want to assign here. Okay, then here I declare one array. Here array equal to np dot array. Here I create a one array. It have some value 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Then I give, just to print within the print, I give the array name. And here I give the type of our array. That means within the print, I give the attribute type and I give the variable name. So it's shown the data types. So I just run this code. Firstly print our array, then after that we print our data type. In our output, we got it. Our data type is numpy.end array. Then this is for one dimensional array. We use two dimensional array means within that here I declare two square bracket. Then instead of it, I declare another one dimensional array also. Here I give 5, 6, 7, and 8. Then I enclose all the brackets. Here I print that array. It's shown 2D array and its types also. In case here we want three dimensional array means here I declare three square bracket and two is enclosed here. Then in my third dimension, I give another some values 9, 10, 11, 12. Then I enclose that one. And then 13, 14, 15, and 16. Okay, here I change my variable name array 1 and I print both array and array 1. The array have two-dimensional array, then array one have three-dimensional array. Right. This is our two-dimensional array, and in secondly, we have our three-dimensional array. Then, how we check the number of dimension? Here we give some array, and here also we give some array, but we didn't know the dimension, right? So for that, we use dim attribute. Here already we call our variable, and here I give dot n dimension dim, so it shown its dimension. Here also I give the same attribute n dim, and it represent the n number of dimensions. So it shown our first array has two dimension and our second array has three dimension. In case here we want to create a five dimension array, means you just give comma equal to 5. Before that, comma n dimension, nd min. Okay, this is the attribute for create a multiple dimensions array. So I just save that code and run here. Here our first array have five dimension, right? I just print the first array, means it shown five dimension. Five dimensions means initially it have five square brackets, right? Then the same way we have using indexing, we can access our array values. So the same thing in NumPy, using indexing, we can access our array. So instead of it, here I give 0 means it represents the 0th position of our first array. This is our first array, right? So here, for example, here I give 1D array, means this is our 1D array. So here I represent the 0th index value. So it will give the output 1. I will show that one. Right? So wait. I want to print that one. Okay, now it's fine. Here we got our first indexed value, right? The same thing, if we use two-dimension array means, we want to give two values here. First one is represent the this is our two-dimensional array. Here I give 0, 1. Here the 0 is represent the number of rows and 1 is represent the number of column, right? Once I print that array means now only this is two-dimensional array. So I just run this code. So here the 0 is represent the 0th row, right? And the 1 is represent the second column. So in 0th row and second column, it has the value of 2, right? So finally we got our output, right? Then similarly for three-dimensional array, we want to give 3 value here. Here I call my three-dimensional array. Here our first value is represent the first dimension, okay, which contain this two array. Then the second value is represent the first row in first array. Then our third value is represent the third dimension, which also contain the 3 value. So firstly here the 0 or 1 is represent the this 2 or this 2 sector. Then the 1 represent the 0 means that will give this sector. 1 means that represent this sector. Then the third value is represent the our values index value. In case here Okay, firstly we run this code. We got 7, right? Where we got our 7? In 0. 0 represent these two rows. Then 1 represent the first one. Then 2 represent second position value, right? 0, 1, 2. In second position, we have 7th value. In case here we give 1, here we give 0 means The one represents these two sectors, and here 0 represents the first column. Then 2 represents 0, 1, 2. So finally, here we got our value of 11. Right? The same thing for all other dimensions also. So using NumPy, we can add our arrays also. And using the indexing value, not only positive indexing, negative indexing also, we can represent our individual index value. So here I give array of 0 is to 5 means, or 1 is to 2. Any one value I give here, I give 1 is to 3 for slicing. I just print my array. The array have 0, 1, 2, 3 values. So I am slicing the array from 1. So it show 0, 1, 2, 3. So it give until 2 and 3 only. Right? This is array slicing. In case here I give the negative indexing means, for example, I give minus 3 and minus 1 means it count is start from here. So this one is minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. So our value is 3 and 4 we will go. So 2 and 3 we will go. Right. This is array slicing using NumPy. Then next, it have some data types also. Basically, in Python, we use the strings, integer, float, boolean, complex, like 2, etc. But in NumPy, it have different types of data. Here I is represent integer, then the small b is represent boolean, then u represent unsigned integer, f represent float, complex float, and time delta, then capital M is represent date time, and O represent object, and S represent string, then capital U represent Unicode string. Then here, the main difference between the U and the capital U. Small u represent unsigned integer. In case we use capital U means that represent Unicode string. To check data type, we just use our array name, array variable name dot data types, D types only. That's enough. I make the all the things into command line. Okay, here I print my data types of our array. So I give our variable name dot d types. Okay, now in our array, we give integer, right? So 32-bit integer. This is the method to find our data type. Then next thing, the array have copy and view. What is the difference between copy and view? The main difference between a copy and a view of an array is that copy is a new array and the view is just a view of the original array. That is the main difference between copy and view. Here, the copy that owns the data and any changes made to the copy means it will not affect original array. And any changes made to the original array means that will not affect the copy. Here, the view that does not own the data and any changes made to the view that will affect the original array. And any changes made to the original array that will affect the view. Here already we import one array, right? So here, I declare another one variable, x, like to that. Here I am going to copy the array in array values. That's mean here I change my variable name. Here I give just x. In next variable I declare like to y. So here I just copy the array of x and I call the and store the same array into y, right? So to copy that array, I use the copy attribute. So first we want to mention our file name x dot copy and parenthesis is important. Then here I print my y. So once I am printing that y means it will give the value of x. Then next I also print the x also. So I do print x. So here x is the our view. View represent the original data, right? Then y is represent our copied data. So here both are same. So here successfully we have copied our data. To differentiate, here I make some changes in our copy means it doesn't affect our view, but we make some changes in our view means it will affect our copied data. So here x index value, I'm going to change the value of 2 here from in our view. I change that value of 2 in our copied array. So I just give x of 1 equal to 20. So now I run this code. In our copied array, the value of 2 is changed into 20, right? Then, here I made some changes in our view. Here I change in copy. Yeah, the value is changed in copy. Okay. So once I change the value before copying my data. So before copying my data, I change that value. So it will change in our view and copy both also. Wait. right? So once we made some changes in our view means, it will affect both copy and view data also. So before copying our data, we made changes mean that will affect copy data. After copying data, we will make that some changes in our view data mean it doesn't affect our copied data. To declare our shape of array, we use the attribute shape, because in NumPy array have attribute that is called the shape attribute that return a tuple with each index that having a number of corresponding element. For example, here I give x dot shape means it give the shape of our array. So I just run that code. Our shape of array is 4, right? In case here I use two dimensional array means, now our shape of our array is 2, 4. It have 2 rows and 4 columns. Okay. In our machine learning algorithm, where the NumPy is help to us, we have some data set, right? The data set have bulk amount of rows and columns. We want to know that rows and columns. So for that reasons, there we use the shape attribute, and we want to copy one data means we use those attributes also. To handle our data set, NumPy is very important. Then we move to the pandas package. Pandas is very, very important in our machine learning data process. Yeah, the pandas. Pandas is here one of the Python library package, right? So this is used for working with our data sets, because it has some functions for analyzing, cleaning, exploring, and manipulating of our data. So the pandas package is very important one in our data set. The name pandas that has reference to both the panel data and the Python data analysis. So the pandas was created by Wes McKinney in 2008. Here, that Pandas allow us to analyze our big data and make the calculation that is based on our statistical theory, and it is used for cleaning of our bulk amount of data and make that data into readable. Using Pandas, we can calculate the average value, maximum value, minimum value. We can find out the correlations and median value like to that. And in case we want to clear some dirty data from our data sets, means here also the Pandas is play that role very excellently. So this is the installation process of Pandas. In our command prompt, we just give pip install pandas. That's enough to install Pandas library package. Once we install our packages, mean next we want to import our pandas. So give the attribute import under pandas. Then instead of it, we can use the alias also. So we assume pandas as pd or pn, like to that anyone value. Then after that, instead of it, we must use the dictionary values, right? In our all the data sets have based on rows and columns or dictionaries values. So in this pandas, we can access dictionaries under CSV files, JSON files, or some Excel files also. Okay, first here I import pandas, then here I declare one data set. I give the name my data. So instead of car, I have some car models names. Then this is the another class. Within the passing, I give its range. Three, 7, 1, like to that. Then here I enclose my data. Then I am going to declare one variable to access those data. That is my variable. Here I give pandas. Here we want to create one data frame, right? Because of this is one unstructured data. Here we are going to make the data into on a particular data frame. So here I give the data frame attribute that is used for create a data frame. Then I give, then here I print my variable. So we are giving our data into one dictionary format, right? Then after the data framing, we got a structure, right? Because the now our data have some rows and columns, and it have the index values and some titles for the columns also. So each and every time here we want to calling pandas means we use the full name of pandas. So it is have some difficulties. So here I using alias, I assume pandas as pd means I just give pd here means that's enough. So now I just run this code. It's also give the same output. Okay, then next, the panda has some series and labels. Right? Pandas has series labels and how to create a label and what is the keys and values. Series means that like a column in a table, right? In that's mean one dimensional array that holding a data of any type. If we call a one dimensional array means here we use series attribute of series. Then we want to create one labels means we just give the index value for that one. Then after that, the index value is automatically assigned to the each values. So here we use the same series one, series attribute only. So instead of it, we use the attribute index also. Then keys and value is nothing but in our dictionary, we take our dictionary data means the dictionary has key and value. So it has some pair of data, right? So the first one is represent keys and the another one is represents values. Okay, now we are discussed the data frame and within the data frame, how we can locate our row. So using the attribute LOC, instead of it, we give some index values means that represent the row. Then how we can give a name for index? So within the index attribute, we give some value means that represent the index, right? Then locating of name in index. To we want to locate some values in our specific index means we just use the LOC attribute, and within that we give our indexed name is we can access the index. Yeah, the main thing is how we can load your data, our load our file into our data frame. So this is most important in Pandas, because in our data set we have some format of files. Okay, so to handle that one, we must know about the file loading. So here I give one variable, data is pd dot. Here we are going to read our data file. So I use the attribute read. Our data file is in the format of CSV. So underscore CSV file. Then next I give my file name. I have shown my file. Okay, this is our data, right? So this is one of the basic sample file. It just have the position and the salary details only. So the same file I give here, data.csv. Then I print that variable means it gives it data. Yeah. Here I want to save that file. Here the main thing is we must contain the both the data and our code into a same folder. So I give save as. Here I save the code into the same folder. Okay, now I run this code means. Wait. So I copy my data set here. Here I create one new folder. This data type. Yeah, I just copied this data. Right, because of the previous file is I have in Excel format, because here we are calling CSV file. So previous data, this is Excel format. So I call another data set. I saw that file. So this only in the format of CSV, it have the some rows and columns of duration, pulse and max pulse and calorie of one's details. The main thing is once we read the total files means it shown first five and last five rows and columns only. Then the remaining first five and last five rows only, then a remaining thing will be represented in dotted lines. And finally, it shows the total number of rows and total number of columns. So instead of it, here we want to read our full data, means I just give dot to underscore string. Dot to underscore string means it shown the full rows and columns. So it have 170 lines. It shown all the 170 lines also. Right, so all 170 rows are here printed. In case we want to read first 5 lines only, we just instead of our file name data dot, we use head means it shown first 5 line. We use the attribute tile means it shown last 5 lines. Using the same thing, in case we read some JSON files, means we just change our extensions and this attribute, that's enough. Okay, the main thing, the next main thing in data in pandas is, in pandas it's widely used for data cleaning. If we have some data sets, means it have some wrong formatted data, or it have some null space, or some, whatever, it have some dirty data, right? So within the dirty data, we can move the further process, means finally it will affect our accuracy. Okay, so here we, once we remove the dirty data, then after that we move that further process, means it will give the better accuracy. So data cleaning is very important one. This one is the one of the pre-processing technique. In data cleaning, the data that have the empty cells, wrong format data, wrong data, or duplicate data, we want to remove those all the things. So the to remove empty cells, we use the attribute import of pa, that means df dot our file name dot drop now, attribute of drop now is shown that attributes here. Here I give the our file name. Here our file name is data, means data dot drop now. Then we want to fill our null space, means it calculates some mean value from the previous data and automatically it fill our empty space. For that process we use fill now data, our file name dot fill now, that's enough. Then so this two things is very important one, right? Then we want to remove our data, to convert our date. For example, we have some date data in our data sets, means in case date is placed in year and year is mentioned in date places. So this is wrong format, right? So to change its format, we use 2 underscore. Date time. We want to remove one row, means we just use drop now, and within that we mention that index values, means automatically it will removed. Okay, then next matplotlib. Right, the first one is NumPy, then pandas, then after that matplotlib is very important one package because of it provide the visualization of our data set. We have some bunch of data, right? But visualization only we can understand that data and further process. So for that purpose we use matplotlib. Matplotlib is mathematical library package of mathematical plot of our library functions. Matplotlib, right? So this is the one of the low level graphing plotting library, right? So this is created by Mr. John D. Hunter. This one is also open source, and we can freely download it just using the pip install matplotlib. Once we installed our MATLAB, means we just import using the attribute import. Then after that we give the matplotlib. That's enough. Then using alias we can represent our values also. The matplot is used for data visualization. We can highlighting our data also using this matplotlib. For in case in our data we have many type of data, means we want to differentiate those data into different colors, means it can be possible using matplotlib. Seaborn also one of the like to matplotlib. Compared to MATLAB, it has some advanced features. So both are same. Then mainly we must know about scikit-learn, right? In previous class, the using of scikit-learn is we are discussed that to install scikit-learn, we use the attribute pip install and the hyphen capital U, then scikit-learn. That's enough to install scikit-learn. The scikit-learn is used for to handle the classification, regression, and unsupervised learning based algorithms also. So now we discuss the machine learning algorithm. First one is linear regression. Yeah, the linear regression is one of the easiest and one of the popular machine learning algorithm because of it is a statistical method that is used for predictive analysis, and that linear regression make the prediction for continuous or real or numeric variables such as like to sales, salary, age, project, product price, like to that. What is meant by linear? So one variable is changed based on another variable, means that we call the linear, right? So here the relationship between the dependent and the independent variable, that's here we called linear regression because of that provide the relationship between dependent and the independent variable. Here it shown the linear relationship, which means it find how the value of the dependent variable is changing according to the value of independent variable, right? So this model provide a sloped slight line that represent the relationship between those two dependent and independent variable. So this sloped lines that give the linear relationship of our two variables, then this one is the formula for linear regression calculation. Here that y is represent the dependent variable. Dependent variable means our target variable. Target means just what we give in our input, that is our target. Then the x represent the independent variable. Independent variable is our predictor variable that represent our output. Then the a naught is the intercept of line that give the additional degree of freedom. Then a1 is represent the linear regression coefficient that give the scale factor to each input value. Then the epsilon represent random error. Basically, the linear regression have two types. One is simple linear regression, then another one is multiple linear regression. Then apart from that, the linear regression have one line, right? That is the lead, that represent the relationship between the our dependent and independent variable. So this one is the positive linear relationship and this one is the negative linear relationship. To find the best path, if we want to find the best path, means we must calculate the cost functions. Because the cost function is provide the difference weights between the two dependent and the independent variable. So in case in our output it have any errors, means it automatically the weight will adjust in next step, then the error will be rectified. This is the R squared method. The R squared is here one of the statistical method that determine the goodness of the fit. To determine the goodness of the fit, we use the R squared method. This one is the formula for calculating R square method that represent the variation between the explained variation and the total variation. Then next one, this is the one of the regression algorithm. In the under the classification, we will discuss k nearest neighbor, right? So before the k nearest neighbor, we just shown the linear regression. We discussed the code for linear regression. Okay, in basic step, first we want to do pre-processing, right? So before the pre-processing, we must import all our library packages that have the NumPy, Matplotlib, Pandas, Laketo, and Scikit-learn Laketo. That after that, we want to read our input data set. Okay, here we have the data set in the file of datas, and that one is a CSV file. So using Pandas, we are successfully read that file. Then next step is we want to split our data. After the splitting our data, we use the some regression algorithm. This one is the random forest regression algorithm. This one, this also one of the supervised learning algorithm. Under the supervised learning, it's also come under the regression algorithm. So before explaining that code, I just give one example for that random forest regression. Okay. So this part is for once we split our data means, then here we import our scikit-learn to access our random forest regression. The set of code is we used for the training purpose, sorry, testing purpose. Then the set of code is used for our testing purpose. First set of code is used for our training purpose, then second set of code is used for our testing purpose. So here import our scikit-learn, and using instead of a scikit-learn, we import our random forest regression. Then after that, here we create a object for regression. We know about the regressions mean, we must know about the what is the process of random forest algorithm. For example, the random forest that combine multiple tree, if we have some decision tree algorithms means it have multiple number of trees. So in our decision tree algorithm, if we have one inputs means it have some possibilities. So which one is mostly liked by the user? So based on it, it predicts its output. The same thing within the random forest, decision tree will be performed. So we give our we give training to our data set. So based on it, it makes some decision, right? So we have some group of data. So all the data make some decision. Then finally, based on those decision, it makes some voting. That means it calculating some averaging of voting. Then finally, based on this voting, it predicts its output. For example, we consider a sports player, right? So they want to take daily practice, but our weather is daily changed. One day is rainy, one day is sunny or overcasting, like to that. So somebody have interest on playing on rain, but somebody feel better in overcasting situation. So based on it, it makes some decision. Then after that, whose are highly like the weather? Then based on it, that weather will be predicted by our output. So that is the work of our random forest algorithm. So once we create a object for the regressors means, then next we want to fit our data sets. Then next visualization of the our random forest algorithm. For the visualization, we use matplotlib. So using the matplotlib, we arrange our data and based on maximum and minimum values, it shown our output. So here in my IDLE, I didn't install the scikit-learn because of some version problem. So I run that code into Anaconda software. Before that, we discuss about what is the k-nearest neighbor algorithm. This is one of the classification algorithms, right? So the KNN, simply the k nearest neighbor simply called KNN. Here K represent the number of classification. For example, K have the 5 values means the number of classes is 5. So this k-nearest neighbor is one of the simplest machine learning algorithm that assume the similarities between new case, that means the new data, and its available case. Available case means that represent our previous data. New case means that is our new data. And to put that new case into a category that is most similar to available category. So that is the process of KNN. So using this KNN algorithm, that store all the available data and classifies a new data point based on the similarity only. The similarity means when new data appear, then it can be easily classified in a well-suited category by using that process. So here, the regression as well as classification mostly used for classification problem, but mainly the KNN is used for highlighting the classification problems. Here the KNN is one of the non-parametric algorithm, which means it does not make any assumption or underlying data. Then this also called one of the lazy learner algorithm because it does not learn from the training set immediately, but instead of it stores the data set. And at the time of classification, it perform an action of data set. So it's called lazy learning algorithm. So this algorithm, the training basis just to store the data. And when it gets a new data, then it classify the data into category that is much similar to our new data. For example, we take some images of cat, right? But the cat that cat shadow is look similar to cat or dog, but we want to know either that one is cat or dog means. So for this reasons we need to use k nearest neighbor algorithm. So it work on similarity measure on our KNN model, then it will be find the similar feature of our new data and that have the cat and the dog images. So based on the most similarity features, it will put that one is either cat or dog. Okay, here we have one shadow of one image. So it's similarity like to dog and cat also. Finally, using KNN classifier, it predicts its output. So this is the working flow of k nearest neighbor. First one is we want to select the number of k of the neighbors, right? Then we want to calculate Euclidean distance of k number of neighbors. Then the third step is we want to take the k nearest neighbors as per the calculated Euclidean distance. Then among these k neighbors, that count the number of the data point in each category. Then we want to assign the new data point. When assign the new data point to that category for which the number of neighbors is maximum. Then finally, all the five process over means finally we got our model. Suppose we have a new data point and we need to put in the required category means, consider this image, okay? We are already grouped our data into category A and category B. When the new data point is comes means, firstly we will choose number of neighbor. So we will choose the five neighbors means. Then next we'll calculate the Euclidean distance. This data point is near to this group or this group. To calculate the nearest neighbor, we want to calculate the Euclidean distance. Then the Euclidean distance is the distance between two points. For example, here the neighbor of those point is this one and this one, right? So next to process, we want to calculate the distance. Then after that, by the calculating of Euclidean distance, we got the nearest neighbor. So we have three neighbors means it will consider those three. And here also consider those three. So that represented in this image. So we can see in this image, we can see three nearest neighbor. So once the Euclidean distance is calculated means the new data is nearest to this A category means it provides the output of A, or B category means it provides the output of B. So this is the K nearest neighbor classification. I'll show the code for the k nearest neighbor classification. So the in all the algorithm, we must import our library and importing of data set. Then extraction of independent and dependent variables, splitting of data. So those steps are very important. Then after that future scaling, we use our algorithm. Okay, the main thing, first one is importing of library functions and importing of our data set. Then extraction of dependent and independent variable, splitting of our data set, and future scaling. After that, we move to our algorithm. Here we use KNN classifier algorithm. So instead of scikit-learn, we import our K neighbor classifier. Then after that, we predict our training. Once we train our data sets, means then after that, using testing, we predict our output. So instead of prediction, we use the confusion matrix also. After that, using Matplotlib, we provide the visualization of our training and testing set. Okay, the set of code is used for visualization. This represents the visualization of our training set, and the set of code is represent the visualization of our testing set. Right? In this session, we discussed this regression algorithm and the classification algorithm. Okay, nextly, we must know about clustering, right? So under the clustering, we discussed k-mean clustering. Okay, here the K is represent the number of clusters. In previous algorithm, K represent the number of neighbors. Here the K represent the number of clusters. So firstly, cluster is represent the grouping of similar type of data, right? Here that k-mean algorithm, here the k-mean clustering is under the unsupervised learning, all know that one. So here, which group the unlabeled data set into different clusters. Here that K defined the number of predefined clusters and that we need to be create in the process. And if K value is considered to 2, there will be 2 clusters. And if we have the K value is 3, means here we have 3 clusters. The first process of the k-mean clustering algorithm is we want to decide the number of k. Then next, we want to select the random k point or one centroid. Once we select a random k point or centroid, means then that assign each data point to their closest centroid. Then it will form the predefined k clusters. Then fourth step is we want to calculate the variance and the place of a new centroid of each clusters. Then the process, the third and fourth step is repeated until the data point is find out its new closest centroid. Then if any reassignment occur, means then it go to the step 4. Then it go to finished, means finally our model is ready. This is the process of k-mean clustering. Okay, now using that machine learning algorithm, we discuss about one project. Okay, in that project, we want to predict COVID-19 patients, right? COVID-19 prediction. in these cases, we want to predict number of death cases and number of recovery cases based on its gender or region, like to that. So based on its characteristics, it has some classes. So using difference algorithm, we can predict that one. So here I open my Anaconda Navigator. This also one of the environment to run our code. We can run the same code in IDLE also, but we use Jupyter's means. So instead of Anaconda Navigator, it shown Jupyter notebook. I just give launch, then it will open in another one browser. Here, why we choose Jupyter notebook means we have output side by side. Using Jupyter notebook means side by side, we shown our output. For example, here we have the first block of code, then the output of the code is we shown here. So like to that, but we use IDLE mean it's not possible. So I just run that code. Here the first thing is we want to import our libraries, right? The first one is NumPy, Pandas, Seaborn, and Matplotlib. So those are the basic packages. Then scikit-learn. Then after that, here previously we import our training and testing data and label encoder and random forest classifier, all the packages, all the library functions are we declared here. Then after that, second process is loading of our data set. Okay, wait, I will show the data set. So this is our data set. If you have this data sets means here it has some null spaces or wrong formatted data. So those things are occurred here. So to solve this problem, we first thing is data cleaning, right? We want to do data cleaning. Okay. So this data have multiple, that's mean huge amount of rows and columns. We concentrate on columns. It have some ID and death cases and report and patient's location and their country, their age and gender and symptoms, like to that. Those are we have in our data set. Then okay. Now here using Pandas, we loaded our data set. Okay. Here Pandas is assumed as PD. Then instead of it, we are here PD.read of CSV file. So our CSV file name is COVID-19_dataset. So the format of our data set is CSV. So here we take just first two datas only. So instead of head, I give two means. instead of head, here we give 2 means it's shown first 2 row. Here we give 5 means it's shown first 5 row. So we don't give any numbers means it's shown automatically first 5 rows only. In case we give 10 means it's shown first 10 rows. Okay, here we call first 2 rows only. So it's shown the first row and second row. Here we define the shape of our data set. So use the attribute shape. It gives the total count of number of rows and columns. It have the 1085 rows and 20 columns. Then in our data set, we have different type of data, because in case we take the ID means it have integer. In case we take country means it have the float or string like to that. All the strings are converted into here float. So gender means it have some, it converted into type of object like to that. So to know about the data type, here we use the df our data frame dot d types that represent the data types. Then to know about the info about our data set, we use the attribute info. It give all the main columns and its null counts and its data types. Okay, then next we use data cleaning. Here we want to remove the unformatted data or wrong data null space. So we use the df drop now. So instead of it, which data set I want to remove, I mention its columns names. Then next, firstly we remove unneeded columns. Then in case in age it has some wrong format data, means it's automatically filled based on its some medium values. So here we use fill now, then drop now to remove the wrong genders. To remove null space, here we use the attribute of isNull. Then here the data cleaning is over. Then explore analysis. So here it gives the number of patients dead based on their age. Then next, it show number of patient recovered based on their age. So based on data, based on some characters, it give the ranges. Based on age, here we classify the number of dead. And here, based on age, number of recovery cases, we can represent. Then this is the comparison of both recovered and the death cases. All the plots are based on matplotlib and seaborn only. So based on gender, it gives the classes. It classified. First one is death patient based on gender. Then second one is recovery patients levels based on its gender, male and female. Then this is the classification of dead patient count and recovery patient count based on their origin. In case whose are from Wuhan or whose are from not Wuhan, based on it, it gives the count. So this block of code represent the number of COVID patients from different countries. Okay, so in this data, it shown that China, Japan, South Korea, Hong Kong, some etc. countries. So finally, it give the number of COVID patients from different countries. So it. So in this project, so using the random forest classifier, we give classification based on its character. Firstly, we give the classification based on death cases and recovery cases. And in recovery cases, we split into two classes. One is based on their age, and based on age. Then next one is based on gender. Then after that, based on region, we give another classification also. Finally, based on voting, we got our final result here. Then this is the pie chart of our data. So here finally predict our death and recovery cases based on voting. This is the numerical representation of our prediction. Here, so using the random classifier, we classify that our testing data set. Here, all the one represent the male. And all the one represent the female. So based on it, it's predict the output. Finally, our accuracy of our model is 95%. Okay, this is our accuracy level. This session is over here. Thank you to all. Ma'am? மேம் நீங்க பேசுறது எதுவும் கேட்கலையே மேம். ஓ ஓகே மேம். ஆ ஓகே மேம், நான் செக் பண்றேன். ஆ ஓகே மேம்.